my presentation is titled From an Idea to a Business. Most of it is really based on how TriLab started, how we got TriLab to where it is. But I'm going to use a different example. At the end, I'm going to give you a real example of a different company that came to TriLab and we helped them to get the idea on motion. And they didn't have money for that matter. Yeah. So what is an idea? Right? What is an idea? An idea can be anything. Can be you saying hi to your mother, that's an idea, it's a great idea. It can be an idea of starting a business, that's an idea. But in our case, we want innovative ideas, right? I always tell people, every time a customer comes and says, we want to develop this new idea, but X and Y said they're doing the same business. I always tell them, hey, guess what? When Google was starting, Yahoo was already in the search business, Microsoft was already in the search business. Google didn't go like, ah, well, look, there are these other companies, so we will not start this business. But Google went on ahead and said, we will start this business anyway. Why? Because Google wanted to make meaning. They wanted to change the way we do things. So if your idea is going to make a difference, it's going to make us better people, then hey, that's an idea worth looking into. That's an idea worth us, you know, spending these few minutes we have been together. Right? That idea must have a niche. You know? When you have an idea, don't have an idea in thin air. You must be able to say, when I finish developing this product, I'm going to sell it to this guy. I'm not saying sell only to that guy. Or if that guy does not buy it, get disappointed. No, that's not what I'm saying. But at the beginning of your idea, you must know where you're going to sell this idea. Right? Okay? So, the culture of starting businesses or starting a venture, they always say, sit down, start writing a business plan, give us projections. To be honest, if somebody has a PhD in business admin who is doing that, I'm not insulting you, but I'm saying that's a waste of time, right? Because I'm a business guy. All I need is money to get this venture going. Now, if I'm going to sit down and start writing a business plan and projections and all this big mathematics, what are you projecting? Right. You're doing this business for the first time. What exactly are you projecting? There's nothing to project. Right? CRDB can project about banking. 10 years in that industry. You and I, for starting a business, there's nothing to project. Right? That's what I'm saying. After you have your idea, I like that little thing. Get going. Move. Right? Let's get to it. How do you do that? Number one, I spent quite a bit of time yesterday trying to read the history of big companies, IT companies. It's so amazing that on the front line you see it's Bill Gates, but there's always a second guy that you all never get to hear. There's Steve Jobs. There's always that other guy that you don't get to hear. Right? So the first thing I think we should do, which is what we did the trial, is to find a soulmate. Now, I would have said a partner, but I said a soulmate. Right? It's for a reason. Yeah. A soulmate is somebody you relate at a much, I don't want to use the word spiritual level, but at a much higher level than a partner. It's a person that you're not afraid to tell them what you're thinking right now. Or when they criticize, when they tell you, no, don't do this, you know this is nothing personal. They just have the best interest they have. We have that person in trial that is called Clemens. Clemens will always give it to you without sugar, without anything. No, Feruzi, that's wrong. You can't do that. So you need that person to get going. Because you know, at every point, you have somebody behind who will say, no, that's wrong. Do it this way. The next thing is get development. Now, instead of you firing up your Microsoft Word and starting writing your business plan, if you're a software developer, you have an idea, fire up your, install your Apache server, get your compilers going and start writing the software. Start, if you're an architect, start building models. Right? Because that's what it's all about. We need to get you going. We need to get the product onto the market. market. Right? And to get going, do not be ashamed, do not be scared to take your product to the market for people to test it out. I like it. How many of us have gone to, let's say, ShopRite and you find a company is introducing a new product, let's say it's tomato sauce. They have this small piece of tomato sauce where you can buy it and say, take it home and then try it for free. Right? It's not that they want to give it to you for free. I always say those guys are very smart. Number one, it's a new product. And they don't want to spend a lot of money on marketing and putting signs. But the best way to market it to you is by letting you test it. So they give it to you, go and test it at home. In other places, usually people go back and say, your tomato sauce is not nice. Change here a little bit, change there a little bit. That's what I call it's free feedback. Now, you would be amazed if you have a software, for instance, and release it for free for people to try it out. Their feedback is priceless. No. And it's strange enough, when you give people stuff for free, they are willing to come back and say, yeah, it's working fine, except there's this part that's not fitting in my company. Not knowing that they're actually telling you the requirement for their company. So you fix it. So now when you go and send it back to them, now it answers all their questions. Now that's a more interesting product. Right? So always be ready and willing to give people a try. Now, try it again. A lot of people usually say, no, we failed our project. Our project, we started 2 months ago and we don't have money. Guess what? Failing is part of success. And if I'm to retract how many times we failed the challenge, we'll be like, how have you guys survived to this day? Like, we have failed so many times, but luckily for us, we will say, oh, let's try it again. Let's try it again. So every time we fail, for us, it's time to learn. So we've gotten to a point where we fail, we're excited. Oh yeah, we failed. So what is there to learn on this one? So we call it excitement. And when we fail completely, okay guys, we're not going anywhere. We're always smart enough to say, okay, let's ask for help. And luckily for us, the world is becoming a little village. It used to be a village, but I think it's becoming a room now. Because now you can have the PHP programmers, you can have the Facebook developers, all of them on tabs. So it's becoming a room, literally. So you must get to a point where you say, okay, I'm failing, I need to ask for help. Right? And you'd be amazed how many people are willing to help. Right? And they're just a keyboard away. Exactly those two phrases. Exactly those two. Number one, your business model, you need to figure out who has your money in their pockets. Number one. Number two, figure out how to get it from their pockets. That's all you need. You don't need to write a long paper. No. That's going to waste your time. Remember, you're a startup, right? You're a startup. All you need is money. So most probably the first year, all you need is to make sure that you're getting as much money as you can. You don't have time to go and write vision, mission, statement. No, none of that. Just figure out who has your money, how do you get it from their pocket. That's it. So if you're gonna say you're writing software, figure out, the university is gonna use this software. Good. So now you know who has your money. And I like it because I'm declaring it's my money. It's just that it's in their pocket. It's mine, it's just in their pocket. Now, my business is to figure out how to get it from their pocket. Once we figure these two things out, that's a good enough business model, right? So let's have random examples of business models. Let's say M-Pesa, right? So they figure out who has their money. The people that cannot afford to open a bank account. or the people that live in areas where there are no banks. How do we get the money from them? By helping them to transfer the money. It's a simple business model. It's very simple. I'm sure if you go to the guy that came up with the M-banking, he'll tell you that's as simple as it gets. Does that make sense? Awesome. So that's my business model. That's how it just works. Now, this is the part most probably that is in line with that theme. Bootstrapping. Bootstrapping. I like that theme. The wood is old. You know how they say when you're broke, your brain goes to hyper mode. You'll be amazed. You'll be amazed how many creative ideas come to your head. You'll be like, oh, I don't have money, I'm hungry. Then your brain will be like, you know, you can sell your brother's car. I'm not saying that's a good I'm saying all of a sudden the TV that's in the house, you're like, ooh, potential business. Right? Now, as a startup, as an inventor, right? The first thing that we need to do, which is I was very happy when we figured this out a bit early at our company, is that you need to have cash flow. Right? Trust me, you can have the best business model in the world. You can have the best accountants, but as a startup, if you don't have cash flowing, it's of no use. You need to have that continuous flow of cash. Now, what do I mean by continuous flow of cash? It means, as a startup, you must avoid big deals that pay after a year for small deals that pay monthly. I'll repeat that. As a startup, avoid big deals that pay yearly for small deals that pay monthly. Why? Because these monthly deals, they are small, but they are many. So now you can afford to have all your businesses running, all your activities in the company running. As opposed to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs saying, we'll give you a big deal, we're going to pay you 100 million, except they'll give you an LPO. Doesn't help. You're a startup, you need cash. You need to get this world moving, right? The second thing as a startup, in terms of finance, you need to ship it, right? I got this phrase from Ubuntu, Canonical. They used to have a project called Ship It, right? Where you could order discs and they'll send them to you. Right. So my definition of shipping is that it doesn't have to be perfect. I'm speaking this from a software developer perspective. It does not have to be perfect. Just make sure it's functional. Right. So my explanation for that is that if it's perfect, then why would they buy version 2 of the software? I'm not saying dish out buggy software. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is it does not have to be perfect because there's version 2. So you need to ship it so that there's actual cash flowing. If you ship it, people are going to buy it. You're going to get money back. Now you have money to pay people to make it perfect. Does that make sense? Get it out there. No proven team. You don't need the best programmers in the country. Now, I know some of us, you have a startup, you have most probably 15 million is your capital, and you're saying, I need to go and hire the Mkono, the law firm. I need to hire them to prepare all my contracts. It's not going to work. As soon as they send you the first bill, you're bankrupt. So you don't need a proven team. You just need a team that works. Right? You don't need to hire the best accounting firm in Tanzania. Nope. If your cousin did accounting, even if they just did basic accounting, that's all you need. Remember, you're a startup. You don't even have that much money to account for anyway. Right? You don't have that much money to account for anyway. So your cousin is a good accountant. Hey, get him onto the team.